Pandora. It's a town where nothing much ever happens. This is where I live with my family. Doctor said we'd be lucky if Arnie lived to be 10.
I could go at any time.
Arnie, don't be rude.
Some days you want him to live.
I kill him, Gilbert.
I know, buddy.
Okay, son, come down now.
Bye!
Some days you don't.
When is this gonna stop?
And then there's Mama.
That's my mom in there.
You see, with Mama, there's no nice way to break it to you.
She's not all that big, Gilbert. I saw a guy at the state fair who was a little bit bigger.
I haven't always been like this.
I haven't always been like this.
Gilbert, I'll need a delivery later.
If nothing ever happens here.
It's those lobsters, isn't it?
Why does it always happen to me?
Sometimes I just want to stick her head in the oven and turn on the gas.
I got nowhere to go.
Gilbert, please don't disappear.
We're taking him in. We've warned you, we've warned your sister.
They say there's a reason for everything.
My son! Give me my son!
Maybe someday I'll figure out what it is.
Oh, look, to praying mantis.
You know how they mate? The male will sneak up on the female, and she'll bite off his head, and the rest of his body will keep on mating, and then when they're done, she'll eat him.
That was clever. You said marker. And I hit the clapper.
Did not. Planned. We wrote that out.
Yeah, we talked 100%. All right, let's chat about what's eating Gilbert Grape. First of all, weird title.
I was waiting for them to say it in the movie and they never did.
Oh, you didn't even think about that. I wish
I thought Mama was going to say it at the end. She was going to be like, what's eating you, Gilbert Grape?
That would have been genius.
She never did. I was waiting for it.
I just hope that, I mean, I don't know what really like press for movies looked back in 93. Maybe similar, but I feel like the question where like Johnny Depp comes onto a late night show, or not late night, maybe like a morning news show, and they go, so Johnny, what is eating Gilbert Grape? Like, that's the question they ask, and he's like, oh, I hate doing this. This is the worst.
Yeah. Well, it's also, I don't know, it's such a, in the name, the grapes. Great last name.
I wondered if there was I don't know if this is true or not, but like just it reminded me of the Grapes of Wrath. I don't know why.
The movie or like the?
Just the fact that their last name was Grape. I didn't know if there was like intentional or not.
I used to get it mixed up. Like the first time I saw this when I was little, I remember like, and then hearing about like the Grapes of Wrath in high school and stuff. I remember like picturing the movie as like, oh yeah, I know Grapes of Wrath. I've seen that, but I was thinking of what's eating Gilbert Grape. I mean, they both take place in like, you know, like farmland, you know, like Grapes of Wrath. I could be really wrong, but yeah, but it's like the Dust Bowl, right?
Well,
like to us, it's just out there.
And I don't think, I don't think in this movie, they're necessarily talking about the Dust Bowl, but.
No, not plot wise, but I'm just saying like setting wise.
Like, I didn't know if that was just like a tip of the hat to that. I'd kind of be kind of curious if that was the case, but generally, I just found this movie like kind of sad.
Yeah, it's kind of a depressing movie. I was gonna say
depressing. Let's get over it. Let's move on to the next.
I was gonna say Johnny Depp's got a dust bowl in his head, so it's like a dust bowl of his life. So there's the relation there.
Yeah.
But, so you, Jesse, has seen this before, and Joe has not. Yeah. So what were your initial impressions?
I mean, I had I didn't know anything about it walking into it. So when I was watching it, I didn't really know what to make of it for probably the first like 20 minutes. And then I kind of got like, oh, like it's this Gilbert character. He's like just doing everything for everybody. And like, in some ways that's like somewhat relatable to like, you know, sometimes I find it hard to say no to people. And I felt like all of a sudden the story became much more interesting, but like also you just felt bad for him. because the guy like wanted to get out, so to speak, or right. you know, find his happiness or whatever that means. And you know, he had lots of, you know, his brother and his mom that he had to take care of, and so he wasn't taking care of himself. Like there's one instance where he's talking to I forget her name, but the girl character,
Becky.
And she, you know, she's like, what do you want? Or like something like that. And he just rattled off a bunch of stuff for everyone else. And then she's like, but what do you want? You mm-hmm. know? And I find it sad because it sucks. He's stuck, you know,
mm-hmm.
but, it made me happy that, you know, you're able to figure out a way to find happiness in the end there.
Mm-hmm. No, I totally agree. Yeah. That's the whole point of the movie is like,
yeah.
getting out of some, well, trying to get out of something, but I don't know. For me, it was like, I remember I saw this as like a kid, and like, I think that's one of my many inspirations of like trying to get out and do more stuff. I feel like, cause I saw this and I was like, that looks like the most boring town in the entire world. I do not want to be stuck in something like that.
Yeah.
But
there's also, I mean, like,
family dynamic. So it's like,
yeah,
it's hard.
Yeah, it's tough because like there's that, like I also, one of the things I always like noodle on when I'm just thinking about stuff is like for a town like, I mean, like we all grew up in a very small town, not quite the same, but like, you know, small town. And so you can get the sense that like, okay, you know, they had like the big store come into town and it was putting the small store out of business. And like, I remember, you know, when we were all growing up, like there was a big thing like, oh, like Walmart's coming to town, yeah. and everyone's yep. like all up in arms about it. And like, it's just interesting. Cause like, I always, you want the people in those towns are usually awesome, but the opportunity in those towns is usually, you know, very spotty, hit or miss. And like, I don't know. I think they did a pretty decent job of illustrating that. And then they had that whole like barn burner thing that came in. They're like, and the guy was like talking it up, like cutting edge.
Mm-hmm, right.
Probably my favorite part of the whole movie.
Yeah.
The burger barn. And when it's driving in, like at the funeral, you know, and Arnie's like, it's the burger barn.
Yeah.
It is a great scene.
It's kind of like the Dunkin' Donuts that was in HFL.
I kept between him climbing the water tower and like running around at the funeral when the burner, I kept waiting for something really bad to happen. Like I thought he was going to get hit by the burner barn.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know. My brain kept going to like, I was like, he's going to fall at some, like I was just waiting for the shoe to drop and it never really did, which I guess is good, but
no, his shoe did drop. Quite literally from when he was climbing.
Whoa, I'm not gonna fall. Whoa. Hey, my shoe that fell off.
Hi boy, that's hilarious.
It is.
I did write down that I like described this movie as like my feelings during this whole thing is like, it's like embarrassing, cringy and uncomfortable just because like, I feel like you're supposed to kind of feel with Gilbert's character almost. Cause like, I mean, obviously he's taking care of his brother who's, you know,
I want him to stick up for himself.
Yeah, exactly. But like, that's what I'm saying. It's a little like embarrassing. He's like kind of embarrassed of his family, like his mom, of course. And he doesn't want to talk about it. And, I don't know. It's yeah. I felt like a little uneasy. I feel like throughout just because like, he doesn't really know how to feel like or act. Cause I feel like the dad thing was like, it was somewhat recent. I think like what, a year or something, or a year or two. Something like that. I don't know. But Leo is so good in this movie.
Yeah. I was reading that like Leo really annoyed Johnny Depp when they were filming.
I believe it.
Yeah, me too. It's pretty annoying.
I really wish I could have seen this movie when it came out, when it wasn't Leo and Johnny Depp. And you know, like when it truly was just like, oh, you're like, that's the kid. You know, like you're like, I don't know who that is.
Right.
You know, I read now that. It's like,
yeah,
like so many movies now, you're like, it's like Captain America, but you know, you're like, it's actually, I can tell it's who is Chris, one of the
Chris Evans.
Chris Evans. You know, it's like, oh no, it's Chris Evans as Captain America.
Right. I read that at the premiere, a lot of the people who came to see it, like the critics and stuff, didn't realize that he wasn't autistic.
Yeah. I was just going to say, Leo did a very good job.
Oh my gosh. It's crazy. And he's 19, I think. This was, 19, his first Oscar nom.
I saw on his, like, whatever Wikipedia that it was like, he got his first Oscar nom, which made him the seventh youngest person. And I was like, who cares about the seventh youngest?
Yeah, who cares?
Like, after, like, number one, maybe two, the seventh youngest.
Right. But there were so many good cameos. I mean, Crispin Glover was in this. And funny because he was the mortician or the guy who drove the hearse.
Oh, right. Yes.
I know he's in like Back to the Future, but I always think of Friday the 13th Part 4 because he does this really goofy dance move. And then he's in Like Mike. He plays the orphanage guy. And he's such a weird person. But
that's like what I picture him at in is Like Mike.
Yep, Like Mike. And then Juliette Lewis was so good. It's funny because I feel like when I first saw her in things, it was Christmas Vacation. Like, she was the sister. And I was like, oh, like, you know, she's good. And I haven't really seen her anything. And then, like, I feel like the past, like, few years I've just seen her in everything because she's in like a couple more Scorsese movies. Like, she was in Cape Fear with De Niro, and she was like a big child actor slash teen young adult actor, which is interesting because I feel like she's not like classically like beautiful or anything, but she's got like this dynamic about her that I don't know
somehow works. Takes. Okay,
yeah, let's go.
Jeez.
I could do this all day. So Jesse, what did you, it's been a while since you've seen this, right?
Yeah, I hadn't seen it probably since high school. I think I watched it last.
I think me too, actually.
It's just really sad, man. It was even sadder than high school.
I know, honestly. It's very interesting. I mean, it's kind of one of those movies where it's like, I don't know. There's really no plot, but there is. It's like, he wants to get out of this. It's basically just like it's almost like a family study, like a character family study based on these
lack people. Of things going on is almost part of the like
right
storytelling.
Exactly. And I read that Johnny Depp's character, he wanted it to be like half asleep, like sounding half asleep, which is the narration sounded like that. It was like very dull and monotone. And I don't know. That's kind of the whole point.
You do that pretty good.
Andorra. Uh-huh. Most very boring town in the world. Dull. I do it well in the morning when I'm tired.
Yeah,
I did forget about John C. Reilly's character.
He's in it more than I remember.
Yeah, I didn't realize how big. Like, I didn't remember that part and how like funny his character is. Just like how goofy, like with the burger barn, like Joe said, and like the whole idea that he's like so into that, but he's like, you know, like always trying to fix their house and, you know, being like, and the foundation's wrong. We got to get some 2x6s and, you know, like all that. But then he's just like the burger barn. And it's just like this weird, odd little side thing that I was like, oh, this is actually, I love that his character's in this.
Yeah, I know. It's a kind of a needed character for sure.
It's like the comic relief. Yeah.
Yeah. But it's not even that funny. It's like.
Exactly.
It's who he is, but it's like. It's just like I feel like just like a good person to be like, just to be around. He kind of reminded me of Joe. He reminded me of you, Joe, a little bit, his character.
I could see it
like,
a little bit.
Cause like, he was like, cause you just wanted to like fix everything for people and like,
oh,
I don't know.
Yeah.
And like,
yeah, that's what I say. Like, I related to that in a certain way, you know?
But then when the burger barn came, like, not that you'd be excited about like a burger barn or anything, but like, I feel like you would get really into something and then it'd be like, oh, like, I don't know.
You wanted to buy a food truck. Let's be honest.
You right. I totally would. I would just live and make a, see? You know.
It was like pretty close.
I don't think it would be burgers though. If I'm
yeah.
I think true. I would try and get a little more interesting than that. But
garbage plates.
I think plates would be a great food truck.
Yeah. I think that could be a really good frozen food too. Distribute that worldwide.
Oh.
Like a microwavable garbage plate.
See,
even more disgusting.
I'm imagining this like
but quicker.
Like one of those, like, it's like just in the frozen section at your store now, and it's like
I'm surprised they don't have it.
That's what I mean. Yeah. And you just pull the box. It's like a TV dinner, but it's just garbage.
Whoa.
Feel free to take the idea, guys. I'm just shooting ideas out now. I'm not keeping them for myself anymore.
Also, how could they arrest Arnie?
Yeah, when that happened, I was like, I mean, they obviously know he's got some issues, but like, he'd done it over and over again. So like, what do you do there?
I know,
right?
It's such a weird, I don't know. It's such a touchy topic. But I feel like Gilbert kind of,
I assume they wouldn't have like a super good understanding of how to handle that. I don't think they were, experts on handling those types of situations.
No, I don't think so. I feel like Gilbert kind of felt a little relieved when he got arrested in a weird way. He was like, oh, it kind of took him off his shoulders for a little bit. But then I feel like when that scene where he like hits Arnie, I feel like that was like the whole buildup. I was kind of waiting for that to happen the entire movie, because like Johnny Depp, so Gilbert's such like a calm, collected character. Well, he seems at least. Perfect hair, by the way. Great hair in this movie.
Great hair. crazy hair.
Crazy.
But yeah, it was like, I was kind of waiting for that to happen. And it wasn't as like intense as I thought it was going to be, because it could have gotten a lot worse. I feel like he could have like really like hit him and hurt him, but I don't know. He immediately felt regret, which kind of showed that he was like a good person. Like how the mom he was hooking up with was like, I want my kids to be like you.
Yeah. Also, that was weird.
That was so weird.
I do love when he's arrested, that scene where they go to get him and Gilbert like runs in first, kind of to be like, just deal with me before my mom comes in, like quick, just let him out. And then they're like, no, you have to sit down. And then she's just like, Jerry. And they're like, oh no.
Oh my God.
Love just like the mom being like, I'm here for my son. Mm-hmm.
Jerry! Jerry! Jerry, I've come for my son.
Sheriff? Sheriff, are you there? Bonnie, you'll need to fill out some papers.
No! No!
Police procedure required.
I want my boy, Jerry.
But Bonnie, you have
my son. Give me my son.
They play with her like so subtle, not subtly, but like interestingly, like the whole floorboard situation where when she's on the couch and they were trying to fix it. I was like, like, I don't know why they put that in there. It was interesting though. Like, I guess to show like that they didn't want to embarrass her, even though she's kind of already embarrassed herself a little bit because they didn't want to tell her about it.
Yeah, I don't think that's how I took it, is like the, just showing how like it's not a topic you talk about and you hide from, kind of.
Yeah. Also, there was so many things in that house I wanted to fix.
See, you are Tucker.
No, like when he said, I like literally went through this. I was putting up beams in our garage and he was like, these beams are 20 inches apart, not 16. And that, I literally had that thought where I was like, if I could use less beams if I just move them out an extra 4 inches. But then I guess you're gonna have your roof collapse on you. I don't know.
House life.
So the other thing I had thought about with Mama is so there was one point in the movie where they were like, are you sure you don't want to go upstairs to like go to bed or whatever? She's like, no, I'm good right where I am. And then at the end of the movie, the big like conclusion for her, and probably for everyone else too, is when she did decide to go up the stairs, and presumably have a heart attack. Did she know that was going to happen? Did she do that intentionally?
That's a great question.
Did she know she was going to die?
Well, like, I mean, she hadn't pushed herself like that before. And so like, I don't know if she knew that there was a high likelihood that that would happen. And that was part of what was scaring her from going upstairs, kind of thing. or if it was literally just how difficult it was to get upstairs. Because part of me thought like, oh, like she's putting in effort and like maybe she's just going to do up and down the stairs and like start working to improve herself. And that's like a good like resolution for her. But then when she died, I was like, oh, wait, like, do you think she was just trying to relieve everybody else of the burden she felt like she was?
I could 100% see that. I mean,
I could see either. And I didn't really know which one was meant to be right. Mm-hmm. But
I thought that I could be wrong. My understanding too, though, was she hasn't slept up there since her husband died.
Mm.
So I thought it was kind of like with the, like going into the basement for the first time where it was like her finally facing the, her, that her husband did die, you know, and like kind of making those steps metaphorically and literally up to the bedroom of like going to make a change. And then I didn't think that that could have maybe put some stress on her. But then I thought of it, it was the nice, like, oh, well, at least she like died peacefully in her own bed, kind of. Like, you know, there was like the nice, but yeah, I don't know. I even didn't think of the other one, but I totally.
So I did not think that they would burn down the house. I mean, it made sense once I saw what they were doing, but.
Probably felt so good.
It probably did. Probably felt amazing.
No, I feel like with that, I feel like, now that you mentioned that, I feel like she did go up there knowing she was going to die because a couple of reasons is that it kind of goes circles back to like the husband and he, you know, he killed himself. And it's like, she mentioned that she just wanted to see Arnie turn 18. And then that was already after his birthday. And then, yeah, I feel like the whole burden thing, I don't know. Cause I feel like she was a good person, but she just was like frustrated obviously and had a lot of issues. But, I feel like she was just trying to kind of lift herself from her family and kind of want them to move on.
Yeah. I don't know that there's a good answer to that, but it was something that I was like, if she didn't do this before, clearly there was a change that drove her to do it, to go upstairs. And you know, what was her motivation there is what I didn't really know.
Right. And it's interesting, like how, I mean, like the Carver, Mr. Carver, how he died randomly. See, that's another reason I think, because like seemingly had a heart attack in the pool. So like, I don't know.
Yeah, he was straight up.
I thought that might have actually been murder.
Do you think she actually killed him? I do.
I was so confused by that whole storyline almost. Like,
I know, like, why
I kept being there? Like, wait, does he know or does Gilbert think he knows? And it's gonna be some twist of like, I actually brought you down here, you know, like some curveball. Or like, I just love when he like drives him home though, you know, and there's like fire and he runs in and he's like, oh, the cookies. But then the scene where he's like, no, they're great. We love them. Kids, eat your mom's. Yes, there's still smoke. You know, there's smoke coming off of them and he's just shoving them in his mouth. Here, have one.
Yeah. And I thought it was funny that he was selling like life insurance to Gilbert. Like I didn't know until that point that that was his like job, but I didn't know if that was like a like unstated threat. It's like, you should really take out some life insurance to take care of your family, because I'm going to kill you.
That's what I thought too. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I was like, if they're leading you down the path of being like, this guy's going to murder Gilbert.
Yeah.
Right.
But what's going to flip?
I know.
Little did I know, so nothing, but.
That was such a weird family dynamic. It was also funny because the mom, Mrs. Carver, she plays John C. Reilly's mom in Step Brothers.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Yeah,
which is hilarious. So that's a fun little connection. She looks the same and sounds the same. She has that voice that you can recognize from anywhere.
Yeah. But, yeah. So do we have any locations? Like, I don't think they ever really said what, I think the town was like Andover or something.
Andorra. We do have Andorra. We do have, it's shot in Texas.
John.
Yeah, oh, I was going to say it's
all Texas. We have the Carver House, we have the courthouse, we have the Carver's insurance, we have downtown Andorra, and we have the water tower. So, but advise him not climbing it.
Do not climb.
It might get you hurt.
You probably will be arrested or hurt.
Probably. Yeah. But yeah, I can't remember exactly where in Texas, but I think it's like the middle of nowhere in Texas, but definitely have to check those out. I think
that town is real, right? That exists. Or the, like the name, I don't know. I feel like one part
Iowa.
Shot.
I don't know if it's...
Wait, was it Iowa?
No, yeah. Eldora, Iowa. I'll have to check that out. But yeah, we got those locations, so definitely check those out if you're ever in Texas. But I also, random fact, I read that Leo Pat chose this over Hocus Pocus.
Interesting.
I don't know what role. I assume like Thackeray Binks, because he kind of fits that. They kind of look similar, but I don't know.
Well, he really made a real dumb mistake.
Yeah, for sure.
Do we want to do ratings?
Yeah, let's do it.
Unit for this week. Barn burners, uncomfortable towers, cake,
uncomfortable
encounters,
grasshoppers,
birthday
parties, 2x4s, 2x4s,
water towers. So many.
Johnny Depp's locks of hair. yeah. Okay, we can do different ones if you guys want.
I'm gonna go with number of cakes, because they had to use so many different cakes.
There you go. All right.
This is a solid 7 for me. I feel like that's like the safest rating you can give.
Default.
Yeah. Like it's either like above or below a 7. And like I enjoyed the movie. I don't generally like watching sad movies, but like that's part of why I think I was happy I didn't know much about it going into it.
Mm-hmm.
Because like, yeah, it was a good movie. It, you know, like I feel like I say this every week, but it's like, if it makes you feel something, it's done its job. And I felt sad for Gilbert.
Yeah.
So yeah, I would say it's just a solid 7, like 7,
all right.
7 different cakes.
Cool. I know this is your favorite movie of all time, so don't hesitate to give it a 20.
It was sad at 0. It's like a 10 out of 10 for classics. Like, it's a great if you're looking for classic movies and like the different eras of movies and stuff, I think Gilbert Grape like should be on your list to check out. Like, definitely solid classic movie. But, you know, again, personally, it was very sad. I kind of just want to go 7-2. I was even going to go lower, honestly, a little bit, even though it probably deserves more. But yeah, there was like, I did like the John C. Reilly part that I had completely like just blacked out, you know. And it is like a good, like tough American story. I mean, not tough American, but like a tough story of life, you know, that I think a lot of people can relate to in different ways, like aspects. Or if not relate to, like, just like appreciate. I'll give it a 7 with the caveat that it is like a 10 out of 10 for classics.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. So, you know,
cool. Wait, what was your units? You didn't give units.
Oh.
So important.
We'll go with, I want to do bikes for some reason, but I just love them throwing her bike in the back of the pickup truck. And I also love that you could just go to the grocery store and then be like, I need someone to drive me home.
I know, right?
You're like, I biked here, got all my groceries, and then you were like, someone's taking me, delivering me back to my house. Well, let's just go grapes. Let's go grapes.
All right.
There you go.
7. Cool. I mean, how many? Arnie, Gilbert,
Ellen,
Diane,
Ellen, Mama,
Ellen.
There's 5. Mama. 5 Sans Dad.
Yeah.
Hi. Rip. Okay.
But cool. All right.
7 grapes, though. 7 grapes.
7 grapes. All right. For me, I love the cast. If you're looking for like, if you're looking to see some like bigger names as their younger selves.
It's the freaks and geeks of TV. I mean, of movies. That's what they call it.
If you're looking for an amazing performance by Leo, definitely check this out. Yeah, I don't know. For me, I like this movie. I love this movie. Haven't seen it in a while, so it was kind of nice to refresh my memory. Definitely sad, a lot more sad than I remember. But it ended happy, which was nice. That was always a good relief.
You gotta make a sad movie at least by then.
I know. Right? I just wanted to see Gilbert smile because I felt bad for him the whole time. But I think
it was a good ending.
It was a good ending. I like the ending. I also think I'm gonna go 7. I'm gonna go 7.
Oh, lucky 7s.
7 water towers. And yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I would want anything more for this movie. It's just like, rewatchability and content is like, it's not my favorite, but I was just in the mood for this because I didn't really remember what it was, you know, kind of about. So it was nice as that. But yeah, I'll go 7 and recommend it if you're looking for a classic, like Justy said. But if you're looking to like throw something on and have a good time, do not throw this on because it's not a happy movie by any means.
Not a throw it on.
But if, I don't know. It could be like a family drama to kind of relate to your family a little bit if you all watch it together. And I don't know.
Yeah, maybe.
Who knows? So yeah, 7's all around.
7, 7, 7.
Cool.
Do we have any movie news?
What do you want to segue to next week's pick?
You want
to
do your pick?
If it's ready.
Unless you want to.
So I got.
I'm hoping there was a perfect segue. I'm just hoping. This whole time, it's been in my head that I'm like, Joe's going to pick this movie.
You have a movie like, that you think I'm going to pick?
It's more of I hope you're going to pick. I don't think you're going
to. I don't think. I'm like way out in left field this time. But
okay, well, let me say it then. I was really hoping that you'd be like Johnny Depp, Pirates of the Caribbean.
Stay on the Johnny Depp train. Actually, you know what? I think I mentioned this last week, but I had just watched Murder on the Orient Express or the newer one. And he was in that as the like guy who got murdered.
Oh, right. I forgot he's in that. Yeah.
Well, I mean, Gilbert Grape's also, like we've mentioned with the life insurance guy, it's kind of a murder mystery. We don't know who did it.
Yeah, it's true.
That's true.
It's my kind of movie.
I just want to say before you pick your movie, we got to mention Bowfinger at some point.
Oh my God, we're really dropping the ball here.
You just did.
Okay, just Bowfinger. Did. We got it out there.
Chubby Rain. Off my game.
Yeah, my pick, like there's no good segue here, but one of the other types of movies that isn't murder mystery that I really like is like historical kind of movies, like wartime dramas. I go through phases where I just love watching like all sorts of like World War II movies and like things like that. So I think we're going to do Saving Private Ryan.
Ooh, all right.
Yeah.
Cool. I just showed Jojo her first time watching that not too long ago.
Really?
She really liked it. So solid movie.
Yeah, it's like I always think it's interesting because like I just watched Midway not too long ago. And then there's like all sorts of people who just like get on that and they're like, is this historically accurate? And they like give you like a whole big analysis on, you know, what parts they took liberties with and what was accurate. And one of the things that I read after reading up on it was that Saving Private Ryan is probably the most realistic war movie, like from, and that it's not like, you know, people who weren't around then to say that, it's like people who were like, you know, who had been a part of the D-Day and they, they're like, yeah, this made me not feel good because of how realistic it felt.
Well, I was going to say it's out of all the war movies I've seen.
Thanks for picking an upper movie.
Yeah, we're going downhill now.
Well, I was going to say, I was like, out of any war movie I've seen, it's like the most, like seeing it is like the most, it's the most realistic, like action I feel like I've seen in a war movie.
The other two that were kind of on my radar for this kind of category was, I really want to see Darkest Hour, which kind of follows Winston Churchill leading up to World War II. And then the other one that, I don't know how realistic it is, but 1917
I haven't seen that yet
for World War One. That I think that came out like
last
2020. Yeah. I don't know, but
cool. Yeah, I haven't seen either of those, so definitely at some point.
Cool.
I like war movies too. I'm not like I don't like watch them all the time, but if I watch it, like I'm in the mood, and I think they're pretty solid.
Yeah, I agree. You got to be in the right headspace for it, but
Jesse doesn't like war movies. This will be fun.
It's World War II, so such a hard topic for me. Like even Jojo Rabbit, that was so good. I don't know if I could really watch again. Right. Like so hard.
Did you watch Inglourious Bastards?
I did.
What did you think about that one?
Yeah,
it was so long. It was like when it came out.
Okay. Did you see it with us in theaters?
It's too long ago to remember. Like I just remember, like I know I saw it, but I don't remember anything about it.
So how do you feel about like that topic then? Like what is your like Jojo Rabbit or Inglourious Basterds, like that Like, it's almost like a satire, or like they almost make it comedic. Like, how do you feel about that? Yeah.
Well, I don't have any problem with that. And like, it is like Jojo Rabbit. I do think that's like a really good movie. Like, people should watch it. It's just anything on that topic is so hard to watch.
Yeah, it's like,
yeah. I don't even really like watching.
How do you navigate the like making it a good movie, especially if you're like trying to have a comedic aspect to it, like Jojo Rabbit, when it's such a serious and like very real topic for like a lot of people. Like, I mean, it was like millions of people, you know?
Yeah. I don't even know. Cause I don't even have a problem with doing like satire on it, or not sat, you know, but like,
it's like, yeah, those are,
you know, but it's just one of those things that it's just like, it happened, you know?
Right.
Like, I don't know. I think I do think too, it's like my great grandparents were killed in concentration camps. So it's just like a weird, like you can't watch it not just thinking about the whole time, you know?
Yeah. So I can't even I even have a hard time watching those movies, honestly. Like,
it's, that's part of what I think is so interesting about these types of movies to me, though, is like, I legitimately cannot comprehend going through that. Like I just can't. I don't know how. I have a hard time understanding, one, how the world gets into a place where this is the reality, and two, like, the things everyone had to do to like fix it.
Right.
I don't know. It's not really fixing anything. It's just like doing more terrible things that hopefully get you back to peacetime. But
yeah, and it's a bizarre, like, I mean, just the fact that it wasn't that long ago.
Yeah,
kind of thing.
Not even.
I mean, and there truly are like genocides happening basically right now, you know, that aren't to the same, not the same level of that, but like nobody really is paying attention to.
Right.
But it's like, you know, like my grandfather had come over from Germany and was a Holocaust survivor, and was like, you know, like he was arrested at Kristallnacht.
That's crazy.
You know, was like, had gotten his U.S. visa with less than 48 hours before, and like convinced the SS guard to let him out because he already had his citizenship revoked, so he wasn't a German citizenship, you know, and just like fled, just left, you know, all this stuff. And like, but it was like 10 years leading up to that, you know, was like, he was a doctor, got his practice removed, people didn't want to be seen going to his practice, you know, like it was this horrible time. And then you think like, that was just my grandfather, you know, like,
yeah,
that was his
crazy,
life. It wasn't, it's not like some ancient like history back. It's just like, oh yeah, that was just then, you know.
It's insane.
It is crazy.
Well, so I don't think Saving Private Ryan, I think, I mean, it's it doesn't deal with that.
It's just like Normandy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's like paratrooper on D-Day.
Yeah. This is Spielberg too, right?
Classic. Yep. It's so good. And a great cast. You're going to love the cast.
It's Papa Hanks.
Yep. Yeah. And there's a lot of like random people.
I've seen Saving Private Ryan is at least when I've seen most of the movie.
Okay.
I'm trying to think of like when I would have put it on, or did they ever make like a TV version that played on like ABC? You know, like
probably, I'm sure they did.
Cause it feels like one of those movies where I've seen like most parts of it.
Yeah.
Kind of deal. But it'll be good to sit down. Actually.
They probably would have to edit a lot cause it's so bloody and it's brutal.
Well, that's what was it ever on TV?
It probably was like... at some point, but it was my first R-rated movie with my family that I ever watched.
Whoa, mine was Superbad.
Really?
So different.
I know. I think I was like 9 or something, and they're like, "Oh, let's watch this." And I'm like, "Okay." But well, cool. I'm excited. Saving Private Ryan. Sweet.
Another a classic.
Oh my gosh.
We're on that theme here. We're just doing classics.
I'm about it. Can't wait to see what Jesse picks.
I mean, wait.
Got to keep riding this classic train. Bowfinger.
I just make a real turn and a real downer movie.
Like, have you guys seen Prisoners? One of my, it's Hugh Jackman, Jake Gyllenhaal, and it's a great movie. It's very depressing, but it's really good. It's about like this guy, Hugh Jackman has like his daughter kidnapped and they're trying to find like this, the kidnapper. And it's really good. I might pick that at some point. It's beautifully shot too. So if you want depressing, I'm going to wait a few weeks for that.
we're going to be coming off Joe's wedding next week and diving right back into depressing movies.
I feel like we're just doing the depressing ones now, and then I guess even Private Ryan, but
yeah, it's not necessarily a happy movie.
Yeah. Well, let's try to see it in a happy way.
Yeah, make the best of a bad situation.
I slightly transitioning to movie news, but I talked about last time Bo Burnham's new special, and then I watched it, and I was like, of course, Day came out, and I was kind of like, oh, I kind of want to pick this as a movie. I don't even know if that would work, but
you can pick it for sure.
Just oddly, basically it's me like, can I just force people to watch this?
Was it good?
So good. I mean, that obviously I'm biased because I love that guy and I think he's like a genius, but this is like a true, like, this is a work of art. This is
really
it's so good. So different and weird and good, but also I think it's going to be a really big piece to look back on in this time, like around quarantine, because it's like it's so relevant in it, obviously. Like he shot, no one touched this other than him. Like it's just him in a room, there's no other people in it. He did all the lighting. That's like really intricate, like
that's crazy,
really interesting. He, you know, shot it, performed, edited it himself. Like this was all him in one room over the course of a year, you know, and a lot of it is kind of on also like current topics, like in the world and mental health. And you kind of even see his own going through it. And it's just so relevant to the time. And it's like so brilliant. Again, like I said before, like what he's able to like convey and like express his thoughts through like silly songs, you know, and like still have it hilarious and like weird, but you still totally get what he's talking about is right. Like really amazing. So I just always think it's going to be like way in the future too. It'll be a really cool piece to look back on. Of like what was created during this time, because you know, like certain movies still were made during quarantine, but it's not like, it's not like in 10 years if you watch them, you'd be like, oh yeah, this happened during that.
Right. Right.
Other than like, you know, there's like, I think, you know, there's like an HBO movie, like an Anne Hathaway or something, you know, like where they did it, and it's about like they're in quarantine, like COVID happens, and I think like even the next season of like The Morning Show. And I think Succession, they're both going to be mentioning the pandemic, like in, it's going to be taking place during it, I think. I heard that. You know, so like there's certain stuff that it is ingrained in. But anyways, amazing.
Cool.
Worth the watch. So good. A lot of good catchy songs in there, man.
All right. Have to check it out. Maybe I'll wait to see if you pick it.
I still go back and forth. I'm like, it'd be really interesting to pick because it's not a movie. It's
right.
It's like not a movie.
Special, yeah.
It's a special, but it's not even like it's so different than just, it's not like I'd pick a stand-up special and we're like, you like that one joke. Like it is more of a self-containing movie than a stand-up special is.
Okay.
But it's not a movie, you know? I don't know.
Right. All right. I could be into it.
I don't know.
I don't know. I could be into it. I'll have to check it out. I'm going to wait like a week or two and then I'll see if you think about it, and if you don't think you're gonna pick it, let me know and I'll watch it.
Okay, all right. I'm into it.
I just not really movie news, but just what I've been watching. I watched this kind of got me back into the, you know, war dramas. But I watched Emperor, which is about post. Like after Japan surrenders in World War II, how they have to investigate to see if he was like, you know, actually for starting the war, if he was just like a along for the ride, and how that would affect like the rebuilding of Japan.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Was it good?
It was a good movie.
Cool. That's awesome.
Hmm.
I'm trying to think what I've been watching. Conjuring 3 came out yesterday.
It's on HBO. I saw that. It's on HBO theaters, right?
I think I'm going to try to go today. We'll see. But it's, yeah, I heard it's pretty good. It's more of like a court case type of thing. It's like the first ever recorded person who like claims that they killed someone via possession. It was like the first like case where they actually like, I don't know the outcome, but like something about like the first case of like the judge like accepting it and basically like saying he was like possessed.
It's like claiming mental insanity. I don't know
what
when you basically instead of jail you get treated for,
right?
I mean,
so I think that's what, yeah, I think it's like one of the first cases that deals with that, because the Warrens, who the, you know, the characters in it, they're like real, obviously real people, and they did like the Amityville Horror case and all these other cases that you probably have heard of.
It's based on that?
No, not based on the Amityville, but it's based on like a different case.
I know, but it's a movie based on that case.
Yep, it's a real case. Yep. All the Conjuring films are like slightly based on something like real. Like the first movie is based on a real house, which they actually did. I think it was Thursday. They did a live. This couple just bought the house, like the real Conjuring house, and they did like a paranormal investigation in the actual house. It's pretty cool. But it's such a creepy looking house. And the second one is based on a real family in London. So that's always like slightly based on something.
Uh-huh. That's cool.
Pretty cool. Yeah.
Dean and I got out to see A Quiet Place last weekend.
Oh, what'd you think?
Loved it. It was so good, right? Yeah, it was so good.
I watched this.
Actually, I kind of liked it better than the first one.
Oh, me too. I liked it.
I feel like they did a good job talking about the beginning and kind of an ending. So
yeah. Well, they just greenlit a third one.
Really?
Oh
yeah. My God.
Well, it's like a trilogy. I mean, it's like...
I don't think it was originally going to be a trilogy, but they're turning it into one.
No. Oh, yeah.
Well, I was mad.
Sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I got the first one spoiled on... I think it was on Colbert when Krasinski was on. John Colbert like mentioned the ending, and John was like, "What are you doing?" And Colbert was like, "If you were stuck inside for a year and you did not watch A Quiet Place, you're not going to watch it." And I was like, "No, I was.
you should tell him.
Well, I'm glad you guys saw it though. That's awesome. Yeah, I watched this scene. It was like John Krasinski. It was like a Vanity Fair thing. And it's when directors break down a scene, and he did the opening scene. And it's so cool. Like, it just, he shows like he's like a genius. Like, it's crazy. Like, I want him to keep directing more movies. Like, he clearly loves it. And like, I don't know. It was funny. There was the cop in the beginning, like when he talks to the cop, he's like a guy from Hamilton, I guess. And there was like a little cut to him in the Vanity Fair thing. And he's like, "Yeah, I got that guy from Hamilton in my movie." And I was really happy about it.
What guy was?
I don't know. Jonathan Groff
or something?
I've never seen Hamilton.
Hercules Mulligan was his Hamilton.
He was a priest or no. Well, yeah, he was like a priest or like a, I don't know. I have never seen it. I don't know anything about Hamilton. So. but yeah, it's just cool. I love when directors like do that. Like when you, I think Jordan Peele does that with Us or Get Out, but it's fun when you see like them break down a scene and how they do it and how they shoot it and like why they do everything. And it's pretty crazy. Definitely recommend that. We watched the Friends reunion on HBO.
Yeah. I watched that too.
It was great.
What'd you think?
It was great. I loved it. It was really well done.
The only part I couldn't really do is that they did like a fashion show.
Yeah. That was weird. And Justin Bieber was just awkward. Ugh. I was like,
it was like also like way too long.
It was long.
I feel like Justin Bieber is probably like, why am I involved in this?
Yeah, it was weird. And the thing is, like, I don't know. I loved like James Corden, but I didn't like that section of the movie.
James Corden was in it?
He like interviewed them basically. I could do like a live interview with all of them.
Oh.
And like, so it cut between that and then them like reliving. They were like doing script readings and they were at the set and all this stuff. And they were cutting in between. And I just thought the interview with James Corden was like a little out of place. Like, it could have been its own thing. I don't think it really should have been in there, but like that was the fashion show. Yeah. That was where the fashion show happened and all that. it was like the Friends thing where you were living all this cool, like, you know, they're on the set for the first time in years. They're the first time they're all together and since like the last episode and like all this stuff. And then it just cuts to a James Corden interview with like a live audience. I'm like, okay. And they're all like clearly like, why are we here?
it was a fun watch.
It was really nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was fun. It made me want to go back and rewatch the show. But I don't know. I mean, they all got a lot of work done, but except Matt LeBlanc. He looks great.
Yeah.
I mean, they all look great, but other than that.
But hot takes.
Hot takes. Yeah, I think that's really all. I mean, just shows and I edited the most recent version of Horror Movie Podcast. If you guys want to check out that.
Oh, cool.
I did another one. They gave Onset a nice little shout out.
Nice plug. So love it.
If you're looking for a good horror movie podcast, check out Horror Movie Podcast.
Do they? I will listen, but is every episode kind of like just like a round table roundup? Is it on? Is it each episode different. A specific title?
So they're all pretty different. Like for a lot of the times they'll pick like, they'll do like a theme. So the first one I edited was demonic babies. So they all picked like demonic baby, like Rosemary's Baby, and all they basically review a bunch of movies. Sometimes they'll do franchise reviews. Like they'll do all the Halloween movies, but like they'll split them up. Like they'll do the first two, then they'll do two, three, and four. Like, and each episode will be like 3.5 hours. So they just go deep into them. And then some episodes they're called like Frankensteinian episodes where they basically just talk about their review a movie and they'll, you know, talk about something completely different. It just depends. Yeah. Everything is usually pretty different, which is nice, but sometimes we'll have interviews with directors. And
what's the most recent one you edited?
One of the hosts reviews Army of the Dead, the new zombie film, the Zack Snyder movie on Netflix. And then they do like this horror Olympics where they basically are like gearing up to the Olympics. So it's like, there's three hosts and two of them pitch, like they get countries, like for example, like Romania and Finland or something. And they'll pitch all of the horror movies. And then one of the hosts will select the winner. And then it's kind of like a bracket. Like they'll all watch the movies and then kind of pick what they liked based on how they pitch and like what they thought of the movies. And I don't know. That's like the most recent one I did. Cool. So,
did you say just zombie or Rob Zombie?
Zombie, not Rob Zombie. Oh, no, believe me, I would be all over the Rob Zombie movie.
I still have to listen to that. I think I sent you Rob Zombie was on a podcast called You Made It Weird with Pete Holmes that I really like.
Yes,
we're just showing up podcast. But it came up the other day again, like that interview. And I was like, oh yeah, I should go back and watch. Like, I know I sent it to Joe. Yeah, but I need to listen to it.
I haven't seen it yet, or I haven't listened to it yet.
Yeah,
I have to do that.
It's supposed to be good. I don't know.
All right. Interesting. Big Rob Zombie fan, so yeah.
Big fan of the Zombs.
Love the Zombs.
Love the Zombs.
That's a hot take. Okay, that's someone that I love, but I get a lot of crap for, like his movies.
But like people even within horror give you crap, or just people?
Yeah, they're. Oh wow. He's got a very specific crowd, like. There are a couple movies where, you know, generally it's like a general horror community likes, like The Devil's Rejects. Like most people like that movie. Same with House of a Thousand Corpses. But like the Halloween remake is a very touchy topic in the horror community. I personally love it, but a lot of people do not like it. And I feel like if you don't like Rob Zombie as a director, like you won't like his movies just because like they're all the same. Like they're very similar. Mm-hmm. They're just brutal. And I don't know. I just think it's fun. They're fun.
All right. Well. Any other hot takes you want to go out on? Or I still think I from last time you were like, oh, and the best one of all. I can't
I
say
have
it.
A good one.
I'm gonna hold
I'm
it.
Waiting
and I was
for
like,
a hot take episode.
Are we gonna do a hot takes
yeah,
episode?
We're doing a bonus episode.
We have to.
We'll do it when we get back from
That's a good idea. Just a bonus episode, a one time bonus episode of hot takes.
Yeah. Like a we can do it's like a 20-30 minute hot take. Just talking about hot takes. We'll do that when we get back.
Yeah, I'm also so curious to see what actually our hot take, you know, like
again, it could be a hot take to someone, but not to someone else.
Well, that's so what like I mean. Yeah, I don't know what general
ambiguous. Yeah. We'll do personal hot takes, like if we think it's a hot take.
Yeah.
I don't know. We'll have to figure it out. Yeah.
I'm just curious of like what we think of hot takes. If everyone else would be like, no, that's everyone kind of agrees with that. And you're like, oh, really? I thought that was. Or you say something that's not, and everyone's like, "That is a strange opinion."
I love those.
I know,
those
I'm pumped.
Yeah,
I'm all for it.
Sure. Yep, start writing your list. We'll do one soon.
If anyone, I'd love for some hot takes to be written in.
I'll post it on the Instagram. I'll make sure people submit.
Yeah, I would love to be able to read some other people's hot takes.
We can make it like a user episode. Well, or a listener episode if we get enough people to.
It can be if we get it. It's hot takes. If you want to be anonymous and send it in, that's cool too. But send in some hot takes.
I will. There
and
was
some hot cakes.
One small hot take. We have 2 dislikes on YouTube now on our videos.
Yeah, that's a hot take. They're like the onset on screen podcast is bad. Hot take.
Although someone did request George of the Jungle too, so
I think we gotta do it.
I think we do.
Yep.
It would be funny to get to a point that we're all we stop picking the movies and we're just letting people pick the movies.
We should do that. We could put like an Instagram poll or something one time and we can have people vote. Like we can pick a movie, all 3 of us can pick a movie, and then someone will vote. And then we'll all vote.
No one's gonna vote Bowfinger.
We'll play George of the Jungle too.
I'll do like The Sandlot 2 or something.
The Sandlot 2.
I used to love
that. That'd be fun though.
Yeah, we should do that.
The second one?
Mm-hmm.
Huh. All right.
When I was a
kid. Yeah, that'd be fun. I'd love to be forced to watch movies that none of us pick.
Yeah, I agreed. Let's do it. We'll do it at some point. We can make one of our episodes like picks. We can do that.
Picks. Hot cool. takes, picks. All right, excited for these newer formats. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm really pumped.
Let's do it.
Cool.
Signing out.
Marker.
Let's do it.
Marker.